I've done the Dakar for 10 years. This will be the 11th Dakar. I think if I haven't learned enough in the past 10 Dakars, I probably should stop. But the passion to win Dakar is what I want to do. I've won IndyCar races. I've won NASCAR races. We've won the Bajas. We've won short course races. You know, I've won 12-hour Sebrings, 24 hours of Daytona. I've won all these races, but the Dakar, I've won specials. But not the main event. We want to win this year.
2005, Robby Gordon wins two stages and finished 12th overall. 2006, Robby Gordon out after stage 9. 2007, one stage win and 8th overall. 2008, two-car team, two stage wins with 7th and 10th overall. 2009, two more stage wins with 3rd and 13th place overall. 2010, three-car team takes two stage wins, 8th and 20th overall. 2011, Robby Gordon out after stage 4. 2012, after 8 stage wins, Robby Gordon disqualified under protest. 2013, Robby Gordon finished 14th overall with 3 stage wins.
Just a reality that people don't understand. They have no clue of what this race really is. It is 3 or 4 seasons of Baja Score National. All packed into 14 days, and the amount of logistics, parts, preparation, man hours, things that you need to do to prepare for this race, people have no idea what it really takes. There's a reason it's the toughest race in the world, because it is. It's just brutal, and the amount of thought process that has to be put into it by not only the driver and the navigator, but every team member every day, so they don't make that one tiny small mistake that might cost you a Dakar rally.
This program brought to you by Toyo Tires. We are Toyo, all or nothing.
The Dakar is just so big. I don't think Americans even realize how big the Dakar rally is. I think it's one of the most popular, widely watched sport there is. I mean, the Dakar is so big over in Europe. Just Americans just don't get to see what it really is about. I've been there and saw it. It's an adventure. It's the world's greatest off-road race, and it's a big challenge. I mean, it is as big a challenge for Robby as NASCAR was. But he's going about it a little different way. I think Robby still has a very good chance of winning the Dakar rally. He's got so much experience now into doing it, and knows what it takes. Knows what it takes to build the vehicle. Knows what it takes now to test the vehicle and get it right. And Robby's, that's the ultimate challenge. I mean, that's, you know, for him to win that thing is just, I think it's a matter of time. I really think it's just a matter of time Robby will win the Dakar rally. He's got all the experience. He's got some great partners and sponsorships behind him, helping him to live his dream also. The first time when Robby decided to go and race the Dakar, he was invited to go there by Red Bull, because he was already sponsored by Red Bull in the off-road, and they asked him to come, and I believe the Red Bull put the package together with Volkswagen. And I just thought that was something that was a little too much to take on, that he hadn't done any of that type of rally. It was more of a rally race than it was an off-road race. Now it's turned into just as much an off-road race as what ours are. But I thought it was a little bit too much, and with not a lot of experience in driving those cars. But little did we know that he'd go over there and win the first stage right out of the box. That's what surprised us all, that he could really do that and did it well. I just thought it was a big undertaking, but Robby steps up to those things, you know, and surprises us all most of the time.
You know, doing this race, we end up traveling through a lot of different environments. I mean, we start in Buenos Aires, which is, on the coast, and we make our way, through the deserts and the mountains, back to the coast, which is, Chile, and, the desert, Atacama Desert, and the terrain that the race car goes through, let alone, us and the support vehicles, is, anywhere from asphalt to sand to, graded dirt roads. There's a lot of switchbacks going through when we're going up the Andes. And sometimes it goes from, a dirt road to a gravel road back to an asphalt road. But, I mean, it's always a new adventure.
Yeah, actually, when Robby had that idea of going from the Hummer to the SST platform, I thought it was too much of a risk. I thought that car was too small. But now, after seeing a little more of their racing and how tight and twisty it is, I think it's the perfect platform. And now that the car is much more developed and suits Robby's driving style. Not too many guys can drive that car like Robby does. That shorter car is a much bigger handful than that Hummer was. And Robby's, he's able to get that thing around. And it's quicker. It's a quicker car, and that's what he needs to be to win a lot of those early stages.
Right when we got back from the 2013 Dakar Rally, we had a great run. If you look at the times, we beat Petter Hansel from day four to the finish by about an hour. So those cars were pretty valuable cars, and Yazid felt that those were something that he wanted to race. So he purchased the cars and two support trucks. So it was basically a complete rebuild. I had to make a decision at that time: do I build Hummers again, or do I build what I think is going to be better than a Hummer? And we built what we call a Gordini now. It's a completely different vision of a race car, a lot smaller, a lot shorter, lighter, and better for WRC rally style roads, but still has suspension, so that when it gets into the off-road section, it still has the capabilities of what the Hummer had. The Hummer was fast on the rally roads, but I don't believe it's as fast as what the Gordini is or what the Minis are in cars like that. So we built the Gordinis, and it was a thrash. We did build two cars at that time. One car we used as strictly a test car. Last year's build was just a different build than what we're into this year. There was thrashes. There was working on Christmas Day, working Christmas Eve. There was nonstop work getting ready for the Dakar.
Last year's build of the HST Gordini was insane. It was just a complete custom one-off build, and we did it in 100 days. 100 days to build a car to go to the car rally and run competitively. It's insane. We did it.
Yeah, we honestly need to be in Glamis in June, doing 110, 120 degree testing, and making sure that all systems can handle the temperature. And we didn't have problems. BJ and his team didn't have problems because we're all testing October, November. And in October, November, it's 75 degrees. It's comfortable for the human body, but it's not what we have to race here at Dakar. In Dakar, it's 115, 120 degrees, 8,000 foot altitude, and it's just different than what we do in America. And we got to change our testing program is what really needs to happen. And if we're going to do the 15 rally, it needs to start yesterday. And when we get back. I have a plan for the changes that we'll make to the Gordini, and we will make her reliable. We started the 2014 Dakar project, you know, we started in the summertime. By the time the build was over, it was getting into our fall, getting ready to get into winter here in the United States, which is opposite. When we race in the Dakar Rally in January, it's actually their summer in South America. So the heat is like it would be in Arizona, Nevada, in June, July, August. So this year, we focused a lot of our time in Arizona, in Parker, Arizona. It's got some sand dunes like the area where I'm standing. It's got some camel grass, got some gravel roads heading over into Swansea and Mineral Springs. It's some of the best off-roading in the United States. And it's hot. It's really hot out here. Today, it's probably 115 degrees standing here in the sun. We've been running the car here for 2 weeks, going through different spring and shock setups, different radiator packages, different oil cooler packages, different fuel cooler packages, and just really trying to optimize the vehicle, not only for straight line speed. Not only for straight line speed, like we focus on always, but also optimize it for temperature. Last year was the first year that we've ever experienced vapor lock issues. I think it's probably because the engine was in the front and all the temperature was kind of trapped there. So we've really worked on the air into the engine, the air off the engine, the headers. A lot of things have been changed on our vehicle heading into the 2015 Dakar, and we're pretty excited about it. We obviously had a lot of experience with stadium super trucks. We've been running for about a year and a half now and felt that that package was very good in the tight and twisty areas. And this is similar to a stadium truck, but very different. And, you know, knowing where we were with the Hummers and knowing where we're at today, provided that we do our job in the maintenance and you know, rebuild and reassemble process, we'll be prepped and ready for the win at the Dakar. We've been sorting this out for a while, looking out into the dust pile down there at the rock quarry, and then there's that pole line. We'll come up the pole line, come through here, and pretty much we'll work on going from sand washes into sand dunes. So I'll start deflating somewhere about where that pole is, try to get my tires optimized to my sand condition by the time I get to the base of this mountain, so that we can rocket straight up this mountain and just launch off into the dunes and then head off into the dunes and try to optimize the best package we can. Dakar is a challenge that is so different than anything else. You know, it's two seasons of SCORE International built into a two-week period. It would be like combining the best in the desert, SCORE International, plus one or two more events, and run them day after day after day. And what it takes, the toll on the vehicles, the toll on the team, that challenge is what it's about. This is our second full week here in Arizona. Testing, and I think the package is about ready to wrap it up and get ready to do our 3 month build, getting ready for the rally. We've been working on the 2015 Dakar Rally the day the 2014 rally started. The reality is all the notes and all the things that we learned throughout the year on the Gordini, the mistakes that we made throughout that rally have all been documented, and we're going to be a better race team because of the mistakes we made in 14.
Okay, so what we're working on today, we're putting the final touches on our primary chassis for Dakar 2015. This is the car that we actually raced last year in 2014, built it in 2013. Through the year, we've done extensive testing. Our last test was Vegas to Reno. We found some issues there. Found some strength issues, endurance issues, and you see a lot of fabrication going on right now. And this is just to optimize everything we have on the car. The interior, a lot of sheet metal work's been done. This is to help seal the car better. Last year, we had some dust issues. We're going to take care of that this year. Won't be a problem.
This will be the seventh time now for the Dakar, the 215 Dakar, 2015, I mean. So, you know, it's going to be fun. It's going to be a challenge. Never a dull moment, especially with Robby around. He's constantly going. Like everybody says, Robby works harder than you work, than I work. You know, he does it all.
And then tack weld the return flange to it, and then match the curvature of the body, cut it off there, and just tack it to the tube.
And that'll give us a better seal.
You want to take those, start piecing them together with some tape?
Yeah.
It's like a big sauna, especially inside the cab. And in the dunes, when we were getting really hot and everything was overheating, it was just like one huge sauna.
Last year, we got in a rush with the body. We built the car, actually, before we had the body. And then we had to fit the body to the chassis. And then what they have now is they're working on all their sealing surfaces. When you build a carbon-bodied car and try to attach it to a tube structure and then seal the cockpit, the driver area, so that it can be air-conditioned, trying to get all those seals and all those gaps right, just so that it stays clean inside. The other side is it keeps the environment cleaner in there, and if you can keep the driver and navigator more comfortable for 14 days, they're gonna have better performance on a day-to-day basis. If every time they're opening their eyes, they're getting sanded with rocks and dust from inside the car, they're not gonna be able to stay in that environment and keep focus on what they're doing. And instead, you worry about wiping your eyes instead of focusing on the road in front of you.
So the idea, the strength is in the structure in the tube here. The sheet metal work is primarily to seal the cab from the outside and create a joint where the carbon fiber body is sealed to the chassis itself. We're trying to make the car as user-friendly and as easy to work on because of the conditions that we work out in the desert. You know, we don't want to be fighting this vehicle. We want to make it easy to do a gearbox change out when it's necessary to change suspension components. And from the initial development stage to now, there's been a vast improvement. We've basically cleaned the whole underside of the car up with hard lines, plumbing, the mounts we've used and fabricated, make it a lot easier to both install and then remove components.
So you have to make new tabs. Just do that.
Problem is that end over there.
There you go. Or you can also send that one down and that can get pulled up. That needs to open up anyways. Sand those ears off that.
Right.
And that'll close you up a quarter inch of it right there.
Okay. So you're good with it?
Yeah.
This engine will be out of this chassis another half a dozen to a dozen times in the build process.
We'll take it over to the bench.
Right now we're cutting the center skid plate for the Gordini. We're cutting it out of aluminum and it's going to be used to mock up the tab on the chassis. But we cut everything that we need to build these cars right here. Everything's done in-house after I design it. I cut it right out here on the water jet for the fabricators and the mechanics. This is the skid plate for the race car, the center skid plate. Protects all the vital components from rocks or other damage during the race.
Every once in a while, you have new people come aboard on a project. You lose people, you gotta replace them. And one thing when you get a new version, you kinda gotta feel them out. you know, you don't know who they are. Come to you with a piece of paper, their name on it, says what they can do, but you really don't know if they can do it. So we're here today. We got Dustin on board. He's new. He's actually relatively close from where I came from in Ohio, so he's an old beer car racer from up north, so that gives him one plus, but we got him here today, you know, working, doing a little grinding and final fluff and buff on the primary chassis for the car. See how good he is with the grinder, see how good he is with the welder, and just give him projects to see how they come out, and that's kind of how you figure out how good a person really is.
That's all right. Hours don't scare me. I used to work pipelines, so the hours here won't be too bad.
The ASO is the sanctioning body that puts on the event. They put on the Tour de France. This is their, you know, big off-road race, the Dakar Rally that they put on. It would be like SCORE is to desert racing. They're the sanctioning body. They use FIA rules that sanctions their event.
Right now we're just laying the last tack, trying not to burn my eyes. But what we're doing, we're putting in the last little bit of the sheet metal here now that we've taken the motor out, and we're gonna put the last piece of sheet metal in here. This is where Robbie's feet will be, working the pedals. We haven't quite decided how we're gonna do it yet. We've got some things to get around. Last few pieces, we'll be able to seal it up and send it to powder coat.
There you go. We're going through this design change on the lower control arms because Robby has used his experience racing, and we've tested and we found out that we want to change the size of the monoball to a larger diameter. The changes we're making for this year, we're looking to increase the suspension travel by 2 or 3 inches. It doesn't sound like a whole lot, but it can make a huge difference.
That's what I thought I measured.
So just in my mind, this week, I'm going to Australia. A truck left yesterday heading to California with the pre-runner. A truck leaves on the 22nd heading to Vegas with 6 SSTs. The support trucks, the Dakar support trucks with all the stuff, even the simple stuff like the medicine that we're just doing an interview about a few minutes ago, it leaves on October 27th for a race in January. So the attention to detail and the pre-preparation is downright scary at times in what you have to do. And you know, I just happened to walk past the medical bag a couple minutes ago. I was like, oh Jesus, we haven't looked inside the medical bag. Fortunately for me, I found a couple Z-Packs, and as you can see me talking right now, I needed them.
Robbie's input is on every single part. He's always looking to make each part the best part it can be, and he wants to be involved with all the steps of building the part, from the design with me, sitting down with me, and we'll work through the design for a preliminary design, and then through fabrication as well, and the assembly of it, and he's there. He wants to be part of the whole process and not just the driver.
All right, so yet another challenge to the Dakar project. The chassis came back from powder coat and the finish wasn't quite to our standards. So what we've done is we've opted to lose another day. We're currently sanding it back to get a better finish. We should have it done this afternoon and back to the powder coater. When you invest so much time and effort into a project, our standards are so high that we're only after perfection.
The reality is you have to go and do things to be able to, one, plan future events, to keep up commitments. And that's really what the guys are supposed to do. They're supposed to get the cars a track. I mean, we've come up with the design, we've come up with the model, It's not like we're going to race number one. The Dakar is different because it's a full prototype car and we race it once a year. This time we raced it twice a year because we raced it in Vegas to Reno.
This is our original prototype chassis. This is what the HST Gordini was based off of. It was a stadium truck that we chopped up and turned into the prototype so Robby could go out and test, I believe, Baja 500 last year. And it came back, sat at the shop. We started on a whole new chassis, and that's our main chassis that raced at Dakar last year and did all the testing with this year, raced Vegas to Reno. Things start to get a little tense around here this time of year. People start getting a little crazy. It's been a long year, and it's the beginning of our crazy time of the year. So you take all that and put it together, and it's just a perfect storm for things to happen.
You know what, I'm not gonna even suggest talk to you about it because you've done it before. And
is that how it's gonna be?
Yeah. I was just trying to give you a nice little job there, and
I can handle it, bud.
Okay.
Good.
Get on with it.
It's definitely a higher energy environment right now.
Scrutineering is a technical inspection for the race cars and for the assistance trucks. They give you a items that need to be on each vehicle. You go through a maze, getting a little book stamped for every station that you go to, from, you know, payment verification to you have your correct GPS to a mapping station to a wristband station. Once they give you your wristband, they give you a final stamp, you get in your vehicle, and you head out the door. The race cars go into a park for May. Scrutineering would be compared to a tech inspection in NASCAR, and the Parc Fermé would be compared to an impound race for a NASCAR type of event.
When the car came back from South America, from the last year's Dakar Rally, came back and just went right back in the bay, and we started tooling around with it and figuring out what we could do better, testing what would work, what wouldn't work, tearing it down, and wanted to try this part. Let's put it up on the dyno. I think one day they ran 109 dyno runs in one day. This is the 2015 Dakar chassis. Just got it back from powder coat. Unfortunately, we have some issues with it when we tinted it for the first time. Had to bring it back, sand it down, and send it back to get repowder coated. Yes, this has definitely set us back, but we always persevere, and we'll do what we have to do to make sure it's ready for the 2015 rally.
So yeah, we've got the chassis back now. It's going to stay in this bay one for the entire build. As components come back, build ready to go on the car, this is where it's all going to happen.
Yeah, right now we still haven't had all our parts come in yet. We're still ordering all our spares and all the parts for the race car. Our SST trucks are leaving the 22nd, which is tomorrow, for our Las Vegas race. And that is November 1st and 5th. What we're doing right now is we're getting ready to load for SST for our Vegas race. And we have one of our trailers holds six race cars. It's a double-decker. So right now we're just talking about how we're going to load everything and the best placement for it to make a safe ride out to Las Vegas. Then right after that, we have the Baja 1000 that we all have to go to. So when we come back from that, it's all hands on deck for the Dakar. First thing we're going to be putting in the truck is going to be all the rear fuel cells and everything that's really inside the heart of the truck. Transmission, motor, fuel cells, all the plumbing, all the stuff that's hidden behind the panels when it's all done, the stuff you don't see.
Just tearing apart the brake assembly so we can get it all cleaned up and then use it as a spare. We'll have one full spare assembly and then a bunch of other masters for the Dakar Rally. And then we'll have our two primaries. That'll have fresh everything, all the master cylinders and everything like that. The Dakar support truck, the Freightliner that we have, is extremely important. Without it, no way of fixing anything, no way of bringing parts and tools, and without it, there's no way to win or even compete in Dakar.
That'd be tough.
Best part on the car, this gearbox, you know why? It's Australian made. Having spare parts is one thing, but one thing I really wanted to try and do for this Dakar project was have every component, every spare part in the truck prepared and ready to bolt straight onto the car.
We have Stadium Super Truck scheduled. The Las Vegas race is still going to go on. Robbie's down at Baja pre-running. Luckily, the trophy truck's in Anaheim getting put together, and we don't have that here. And at the same time, with all that going on, we got the dreams and hopes of chassis number two coming off this plate and having somebody in it and having a two-car team down at Dakar this year.
It's just ultimately important for that support truck to get to the next bivouac, the next night of work. Like I say, without us, Robby can't do it. It has to be a whole team effort. And then you have the personalities, and then you have, did you bring this part? I didn't bring this part, or I did bring this part. After all this preparation, there's always something that got forgotten or they got missed. We have checklists for our checklists, and still there's still things that we leave behind, whether it be a nail clipper or a certain bar soap that you like, whatever.
So our Freightliner F1 service truck just got back from some modifications we had done. I love this thing. This truck's one of the coolest trucks at Dakar.
The truck behind us right now is our lives during Dakar. It's our home, it carries all our spare parts.
So right now we just got back the Freightliner from Elite in Michigan. We had them outfit the Freightliner with an extra room that unfolds on the side so that we can have a place to sleep at night. We're gonna try this deal out.
It's amazing. Wait till it's open.
The Freightliner is our home away from home for the duration of the rally. It has everything we need, all our spare parts, all our tools, and even living quarters, shower, bathroom, kitchen, working desk, everything you need. It's really a step above what most teams bring.
I haven't seen this in a year, and last year to get this thing ready was a feat in itself. Thrashed on SST, thrashed on this, and then thrashed on the Gordini and get it ready. I feel like we're a lot more organized this year, for sure.
But these are the two of the most dramatic, on-off-road trucks you can have, probably. It's the main star of the Dakar 15, besides the race car. And Robby, of course.
Robby is coming back on the Friday, so it'll be good to have him back here to stir things up again. We generally have a plan. He comes in and turns it sideways, but it'll be good to have him back.
So
got back from Baja, just kind of met with all the guys, got a good lay of the land of what's going on. As you can see, we've got parts and components all over the shop. It may seem like a mess right now, but it's because we're getting it laid out to organize it, to put it in the truck so it's easy to find once we're at the rally with a full manifest going alphabetical and then by the part. Unfortunately, right now I got a break. I got a phone call with my partners at Speed, and we'll be down with that for probably 45 minutes and then back to action. But I think guys have done a good job while I've been gone. I'm pretty impressed with what I see. My list is not that big. I think I might have added 5 things to it, which is not that big of a deal when you're talking about 1,500 to 2,000 items already on it.
It's organized, so it's not going to be full to the brim, but everything's in its place. As you can see, we've got drawers that are all labeled, marked. We know exactly where everything is. So in the heat of a service, we know where to go for the part that we need. It makes it a lot easier and faster for our overnight stops.
It could be anything. Anything can happen there. People die on the rally. People make friends. People fight. Most of the people, though, are fun to be around, and it's fun to go eat with all these people, and there's no English spoken. It's all Spanish. French, Belgian. It's a fun deal.
We built these freight liners. You know, we used to run Mercedes 4x4 and 6x6 trucks, and we, you know, had this dream to make the ultimate, you know, pit vehicle that would support our team and do it on another scale that, you know, the other teams haven't. But we took a cab over, and a sleeper cab, and we made it a crew cab. So we actually Frenched in 2 more doors in the rear to make it an actual crew cab truck that would fit, you know, 5 crew members. And then we had a box made, 30-foot box that would eventually house all of our equipment. And we have a full side that opens up, and it stores all of our spare parts along with a kitchen and a sleeping area for the crew guys once they're done working on the car.
If you take guys with half the skill and half the will to do the race, you're not gonna do anything. You're not gonna win. You gotta have the best of the best of everybody, mechanics, truck drivers, race car drivers.
Saturday, October 25th, obviously we're starting to get into that crunch time zone. I finished up pre-running at Baja, came back here to regroup with the guys that are working hard in Charlotte. Got a bunch of different projects going on all over inside the shop. Behind me is our large support vehicle.
It'll be good to get the truck packed up and away on Monday. We can then concentrate all our attention on building this race car, both these race cars.
Back behind me, these are some of the Dakar tires that are getting mounted. You start thinking about the amount of tires it takes. If you just put 2 tires on every day, you're looking at having to have 28 spares if you put on 2 every day. Normally we can go every other day on fronts, and we got a little program we do with our tire swapping to be able to get through the rally. Since Toyo makes such a great tire, and it's a reliable tire, we'll run tires, the front tires, on the front one day, on the back the next day, on the front the next day, back the next day, so that we got good rubber on the car the whole rally.
Okay, we got more. We're getting ready for Dakar, and like everything else, we go with brand new stuff, including decals. So we're basically getting everything bright and shiny and polished and looking brand new, so we can go down there and win the thing, and not just win the thing, but look good doing it.
Well, obviously, you look at the short course side of things with Stadium Super Truck. We've got our brand Traxxas, who's involved there, Speed Energy, and then Toyo Tires. And, you know, this is a marketing game. Sunday, October 26th. bomb hasn't dropped too bad yet. Most of the guys got out of here on Saturday night. 6:37. A few of us were here till 9 o'clock, but all in all, I feel like we're getting through our list. Here's the rear. And this is the front.
All right, what we have here on this table is the last of our
things that we need to either do to the Freightliner or put on the Freightliner.
One coil, one bypass perfect. What we're doing here is basically trying to find places to put stuff. We had those shocks hanging up top. When we bring the coils with us, now we can just put the coils on those three other shocks, which will be six coils that'll have a place to go instead of rolling around in the truck, getting beat up, beating up other pieces of equipment. We're trying to find places where stuff can go and live as complete units. Yeah, even the support truck gets a beating. You know, it's gonna do, it's probably gonna do 2,000 to 3,000 miles in the dirt. Going over the Andes is a gravel road, so it's not like, how you say it, Highway 77 or 91 in LA. 91 would be a dream, even though it's a washboarded road.
So this crazy wall you can see here, it's all the bracketry for the precise fitment of our suspension components. We've got steering racks here, radius rods, everything's secure in its place. We know where it is.
So just pull me two off of here, because they're going
to
be the same.
The amount of thought that goes into putting this package together to do this one race, and we're talking it's the biggest race in the world, I believe, and it's what's needed to get there.
These are done too.
Since the start of this project, we've got lists on top of lists on top of lists. There's lists about lists.
This program brought to you by Toyo Tires. We are Toyo, all or nothing.
I'm glad that you're saying it's craziness like I'm saying it's craziness, because there's like four things wrong with one drive shaft. From seal to seal is 2.4. This comes down to the same thing that we keep talking about. You know, you can, in motorsports, it's the little things that win races. It's not did the drive shaft show up, it's did the little drive shaft fit in the car. And this is a perfect example. Can you imagine if we would have showed up in South America and pulled these things out of the box over there? You know, probably would have pulled them out on day four, not even looked at them until day four, went to go replace the part that was in the race car, and realized that we don't have enough spares to do the rest of the rally. And if we were to ding one drive shaft, we'd be out, or break one yoke like we did testing this year, we'd be out. We can't handle stuff like this. We gotta make sure that everything is perfect. From the front bumper to the rear bumper, all the way through.
It's 9:56, October 27. We're in the final stages of loading this F1 truck.
Final load period of it, and you know, we've got everything on our wish list. I know you've seen that thing we wrote over on the table there, and everything has a line through it with an initial on who did the job. And you see, we're kind of just hanging out, we're waiting for the last part to come.
Robby and the boys. I think they get out of here at
3 or 4 o'clock, and here it is 5:15, 5:20, and we're leaving to go to Jacksonville, Florida. So we're just gonna roll out of the shop here and head down the road. It's about a 6-hour trip, and get this thing into the port of Jacksonville, Florida.